So, first of all, how are you? We've talked on the phone, but I haven't seen you in quite some time. But are you hanging in through the pandemic, through the isolation, the quarantine, and how are you doing?
Well, as you know, Eric, there's no makeup during the pandemic, so the less you see me, the better I look. We don't have those people who take care of us and make us look good. So I'm doing well. I mean, like, first of all, how are you doing? You had it tougher than I did. You had to go through the full quarantine. How are you?
I'm doing well. I've told the story a couple of times on the air that, you know, when the Raptors got back from that road trip against the Utah Jazz, you know, I was told for a number of reasons, not only the potential exposure to Rudy Gobert, and then as we would find out, the exposure to Donovan Mitchell, and the fact that right prior to being in Utah, we were in California for 5 days in Sacramento and San Francisco prior to that. And at that point, by the time this had all come out, California was now under a state of emergency. So for a number of reasons, not the least of which as well, was flying home with the Raptors, who had been playing against Gobert and being on the charter and the recycled air and everything else. What we were told is, Elliot, we were considered super spreaders or potential super spreaders, which is why we were told we had to get tested. So when I had my test, it was, you know, lock it down in full on isolation for at least 3-4 days until your results come back. And then once my results came back, it was a decision that I just kind of made, you know, personally, privately with my wife, and, you know, my wife and son. And we just kind of made the decision that it was going to be safer for me to stay locked in the room because of this incubation period that they've been talking about, 5 to 14 days. The guilt that I would have felt had I come out of the room thinking that I was safe, thinking that I was healthy, only to maybe find out 2, 3, 4, 5 days later that I was actually sick and potentially have already spread it to my wife or my son. We made the decision, lock it down for 14 days. So I stayed in that room, that 10 by 10 bedroom, and just stayed alone. And my wife left food at the door and just knocked on the door, walked away. And I'd open the door and grab the food. And I just stayed locked in for the 14 days. So luckily, knock on wood, I was negative. I stayed healthy. I've been healthy since, and the family's safe. And we kind of just have gone on about our regular, you know, quarantining, social distancing, and just trying to be as safe as possible since then.
Now, honestly, has Shannon admitted that that was her favorite part of the marriage so far?
If you want me to be honest, you know, this is the first episode. I'm going to bare myself. Yes, you know that. In fact, when I came out, I think the first thing she said, all right, do I get 14 days now? Can I go in isolation and get a little vacation or something? So, all joking aside, she was outstanding to me. Yeah. My wife and kid were great. But, you know, she certainly, she had to bear the brunt of it for 14 days, doing all of the, you know, all the food prep and all the meals and everything else and whatnot. As you know, any married man or woman out there, anybody in a relationship can attest to, if one person's carrying the load, it puts a lot of pressure on that person. So she was a trooper, to say the least. So.
Well, we both overclubbed, as people say it. We married people
Yes.
who are far too good and far too smart for us. So they take care of us when we're in tough times. No question about it.
Now I want to say this, Elliot. Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead. But no, you go ahead.
You go ahead. Go ahead.
I was going to say, like, where did we first meet? Like, what's the first? Like, where did we first meet each other?
All right. So this is where I actually wanted to start. So I'm glad you brought it up. It's great. Okay. Great minds think alike here, because What I kind of want to do with this, you know, we'll call it a show, but it's just two guys chatting. And I, you know, I'm hoping to do this every, you know, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday for as long as it takes. But the reason, and I'll tell the folks that are watching right now, the reason I wanted to do this with you first and have you as my first guest.
I'm just retweeting your Instagram message. So go ahead.
Mm-hmm. All right. And by the way, somebody just wrote in as we're talking. And folks, I'm going to do my best to try and pay attention to the comments. I'm not trying to ignore you, but I'm here to talk to my guests as well, and I'm going to try to incorporate some questions as I can, but trying to talk and listen and read at the same time, I can barely do one thing, let alone three things. But somebody just wrote that you look like Alec Baldwin from the movie The Edge. I don't know if you remember that. I think it was with Anthony Hopkins, where they were out in the wilderness or something.
I never saw that one. I've gotten a little bit of The Revenant, although somebody said you're an uglier Leonardo DiCaprio from The Revenant. That's what someone tweeted at me. I thought that was pretty good.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah.
Well, hey, you know, there are worse things than being an ugly Leonardo DiCaprio. all right, let me go back here. So the reason I wanted to have you on first, and I promise folks that are watching right now, even if this embarrasses Elliot or not, I'm not trying to blow smoke up his backside here, but I've told him this in person. I've said this in interviews for years when people have talked to me, college kids or otherwise. I owe a major debt of gratitude to Elliotte, personally and professionally, because not only has he been good to me as a man over the years, but professionally speaking, when I came to the radio station, the Fan 590, now Sportsnet 590, the Fan, when I came there in the early to mid 90s as an intern straight out of college, I was scratching and clawing and nipping and clawing at the heels of Nelson Millman and Doug Ackhurst and Chris Clark, the general manager, the program director, the sports director at the radio station, just trying to allow me to do something beyond producing, beyond just cutting tape and helping out. And I was willing to do anything. I did coffee runs. I produced the junior hockey magazine with Gino Retta. And to this day, Gino still owes me, you know, hundreds of dollars for his Harvey's hamburgers every week that he would always run in late and say, you know, sorry, I didn't have time for dinner. Can you go grab me my dinner? And I would do whatever it was, whatever yes. it took, I would do it. Yeah. But I was always saying, is there anything else I can do? And as a rabid basketball guy, I wanted to get down to Raptor games. The team had only been around now for a season or two. And the original reporters at the Fan, the guys that were covering the team from the get-go, Elliotte Friedman, George Strombolopoulos. And I was trying my damnedest to get down to practices, to games, to get in to do visitors' locker room, to you know, help carry cords, do whatever it took to help you guys out, to be a part of it. And not only did you kind of take me under your wing and show me the ropes and you were kind to me, but then a few years later, when you ultimately made the decision to leave radio to explore ventures in television and go to Headline Sports, which became The Score, had you not left, I'm not sure if doors opened for me as quickly as they did, because as everything kind of all happened at once, not only am I coming out of college right as the Raptors are starting, but I'm now working at a pretty young age as an intern, then as a part-timer, then as a full-timer, still at a pretty young age. And then on top of that, the Raptors leave CFRB 1010 in Toronto. They come to the Fan 590. The Fan acquires the rights. They hire Chuck Swirsky and Jack Armstrong as the new play-by-play team. And as all that is happening, you decide to leave to explore TV. So suddenly now there's an opening. Barry Davis and I take over pre-af and post. Barry leaves after 1 year, and I take over full-time pre-af and post at 25 years old, which is crazy and unheard of. And it might not have happened had you not ultimately decided to explore other ventures. So that's why I wanted you to be guest number one, because I don't know where my career is right now if you are still in the radio, if you don't go into TV and ultimately, you know, achieve the heights that you have in the television world.
Well, first of all, I'm laughing at the guy who called me Obi-Wan Friedman. I don't know if that's a male or a female, but I think that's a good line. You know, Eric, like, you know, first of all, there's a couple of things there. Like, the number one thing is that I never wanted to be a dick. Like the number one thing is I've always believed that you treat people the way they treat you. And when I first started, there were people like Dan Shulman and Scott Metcalf and Howard Berger who gave me a chance. And I always said, you know, someone gave me a chance, I have to help give someone else a chance. And so that was big to me. Like, if someone worked at it and kept their mouth shut, and you might not believe this, listeners out there, that about me and Eric, but when we both first started, we barely said anything. We kept our, like, we talk so much now, you wouldn't believe it. But back then, we kept our mouth shut and we did whatever people told us to do. So, you know, that was big. And so Eric started, you know, he did everything as he mentioned, and I just wanted to help. And, you know, that was, if you can ever help someone out there, take a step, especially now, we all need help now getting through this, it is rewarding to do it. But Eric, there's a story, and you'll remember the story about when the ownership, first real ownership battle happened, the story broke, and you had to drive to Hamilton in rush hour, because I
Buffalo.
Couldn't go.
Buffalo.
Okay, it was yes. Buffalo.
Yes.
I couldn't go because the story was breaking, and I had to cover it, so you had to go. And you, the traffic was so bad that you had to come back, and you were so devastated. You thought you failed.
Yes.
And we were like, no, you made the effort. It's all good. We made it work out. But that was the thing I always remembered, is you were willing to make the effort.
You know, I remember that because you were covering the story, and you, I know you were doing a lot of stuff with McCowan on primetime. And they told me, now this is going back, folks, to the day, and I don't know where folks are listening or watching from, but the original Fan 590 studios were at 40 Holly Street, which is at Yonge and Eglinton. So if you're familiar with Toronto, you know Yonge and Egg. If you're not from Toronto, it's basically kind of not quite midtown. It's more like upper Toronto, you know, a little bit closer to the 401 than to the downtown core. And I think it was Elliot probably sometime right around 4 o'clock on a Friday. So to get from let's just call it, you know, upper town, midtown Toronto at 4 o'clock on a Friday to know that you've got to get to Buffalo for a press conference, I think at like 6 or 6:30. It was damn near impossible, but the bosses said, get there, do your best. And I was born and raised in Burlington, which is about maybe 40 minutes outside of Toronto. And I got to Burlington at 6 o'clock. I still had at least another hour to go to Buffalo. So I pulled off the highway and drove up to my parents' house. And I was convinced, I mean, convinced, I'm done. I'm fired. Like, I'm out the door. I didn't get there in time. I failed on the assignment. I was devastated. And I wanted to turn right back around and just go back right back to the radio station. I remember my parents even saying, well, you got to at least sit down and have dinner or something. And I was crushed. I thought you were going to hate me and be pissed off of me. I thought the bosses were going to get rid of me. I thought I was done. I didn't want to show up at work on Saturday, let alone on Monday. I am done. And just to know that everybody ultimately had my back, and it was ultimately that moment, that first moment for me within the industry where it was like, hey, shit happens. You did your best. You tried to get there. We will move on. We'll still get the story covered. You didn't fail. It's okay. And there was light at the end of the tunnel. But I absolutely remember that moment. I also remember, to your point about not saying a word, I barely said a peep for probably a good 6 months, if not longer, especially between 4 and 7. Because when I heard that music playing and Bob McCown was walking through the hallways, whether it was Bob or anybody connected to Bob, to me, it was like, that was God walking the hallways. I was not going to say anything. And I remember to this day, even the fact that you were one of the few guys over the years that Bob would regularly bring on as a, not only as sort of an insider, a co-host, but also a guy whose interviews he would play. Because that doesn't happen a lot, even to this day on the station. Hosts don't often replay interviews from other guys. And I can remember with a regular basis, Bob going to a lot of the interviews that you did. And that's one thing, Elliot, that also stands out with me. And part of the reason I wanted to bring you on too is I talked about when I mentioned doing the show, I enjoy talking to people. I enjoy interviewing people. And I mentioned specifically David Letterman, Howard Stern, George Strombolopoulos, and you would be in that group of guys. I would throw Peter Mansbridge in there. The one thing I remember that stood out with you, especially when you went to the score and had a chance to really stand out as an individual, I always thought you were an outstanding, and still to this day are, an outstanding interviewer in terms of the way that you're able to speak to people and pull information out of folks.
You know, Eric, honestly, I think I lost that skill for a while when I first got to Sportsnet. And I don't think that's Sportsnet's fault. I think it's my own fault. You know, I love doing interviews. I love talking to people, and I appreciate that. That's very nice of you to say. I think that, you know, at the Fan, I did a lot of interviewing and I loved it. And at Score, I did a lot of interviewing and I loved it. And at CBC, I did a lot of interviewing. I loved it. And when I first got to Sportsnet, I didn't interview as much, and I think I lost some of it. And that's nobody else's fault but myself. I just wasn't in the role. It's like anything else. You have to practice, right? And if you don't practice, you're not going to do as well. And lately, I've started to interview again, and I think I've gotten better at it. I think the other thing too, Eric, and we will both work for a guy named Nelson Millman, and he was one of the two guys who said this to me, that I used to bring the heat too much. You know, you're going to have to try to, you have to be like a pitcher who mixes up the pitches. Sometimes you bring the fastball and you put it underneath the chin, but sometimes you got to do the curveball, sometimes the changeup. And I think now, I really, the thing I like to do most when I interview is get information out of people. And, but you also have to be able to make them laugh. You have to make them comfortable. And I think I'm better at that now than I was when I was younger. I think age, comfort. And, you know, the other thing, Eric, is there was a time when you and I, we were the youngest guys, not at the same time, but there was a time I was the youngest and there was a time you were the youngest. And now I'm older than everybody. I'm about to be 50. These athletes, they're 40% my age. So you better find a way to get into contact with them and make them laugh and comfortable. Because most of them, they're looking at me like, you could be my dad or potentially even my very young grandfather. So you better adjust what you can do.
I've never thought of it as in a grandfather context. Maybe you, I mean, you got it 4 or 5 years on. I just turned 45 last
week. I got white in the beard, so that's what it is.
Well, I got lots of weight coming in under the hat right now. But let me ask you this from an interviewing standpoint to pick your brain, and I'm doing this for my own sake, let alone for people watching. When you talk about trying to find that comfort zone with somebody, do you think that it can be something that you can kind of go into an interview hoping to achieve or being certain to achieve, or does it have to happen organically? Because you can think that you're relaxed, you can think that you're open and accepting and coming off as non-confrontational, but if somebody doesn't like the way you look, the way your body language is, the way the tone of your voice is, it could set something off right from the get-go.
Well, I think there's a couple of things. Number one, you have to have good small talk. Like sometimes in TV, the guest sits down, the cameraman wants to adjust a couple of things. Like the light doesn't hit the person's face properly, yep, or, you know, something like that. Or they're taller than you think or whatever. So you better have good small talk. I used to be terrible at small talk. I hated small talk. That just wasn't only doing interviews. I'd go into like social scenes to make small talk with people. And I was awful at that too. So I had to get better at my small talk. Number two, if you have time, make sure you have a couple of softballs at the beginning to warm the guest up. Yeah. Number three, make sure you're listening to them. Like there's nothing a guest hates more than when they give an answer and you just move on to the next question. So you got to be listening. And I wasn't always great at that. But the other thing is I would always ask someone, give me one thing about this guy that I can talk to them about that will make them ease. Like Shea Weber of the Montreal Canadiens is a great guy, but he doesn't like small talk. He hates small talk 50 times more than I do. So someone said to me, and I would never be able to crack him. Someone said to me, Shea Weber is the NHL's fantasy football king. So I asked him about fantasy football. It changed like that. That's the kind of research you got to do.
You know, it's interesting, Elliot, and I don't know if you would agree this or not, but based on what you were talking about, listening to people, I was referencing earlier that, you know, anytime I've been interviewed or some, you know, college or university student asks me about, you know, what's the one piece of advice, or there's one thing I always come back to, and you kind of just hit on it. I've never, and I don't know about you, I have never in my life, and I could turn the camera right now and show you, I'm just sitting in my basement on the couch. Now, granted, I've known you for a long time. I haven't written anything down. I did some research on you of stuff that I maybe didn't already know. I wanted this to just be natural anyways in terms of what I do know about you professionally, let alone personally as friends for 20 plus years. But even if I were going into an interview with, I don't know, Fred VanVleet or whomever, I've never in my career written a question down because my prep is the hour, the day, the week before the interview, knowing in my mind, where do I want to go with this interview? What do I want my first question to be? How do I want to start this interview? And then to that point, listen. And I might have memorized the next 3, 4, 5, 10 questions. And I might know in my mind how I'd like to kind of structure this interview if it goes off as planned. But I can't stick to that plan and to that script because whomever I'm interviewing might say something sideways in the first answer, in the third answer, or not even sideways, but just something thought-provoking that ultimately allows me to go in a different direction with the interview or with my line of questioning. And if I'm so focused on getting to question 4 after question 3, I'm not going to be listening and I'm going to miss that nugget. I'm not going to be able to properly follow up. And it's going to come across, I think, in the interview that I wasn't listening and that I missed an opportunity to really follow up on something or jump on something, whether it's intriguing or inflammatory or otherwise. If you're not listening, you're going to miss a ton of stuff.
I agree with that. I agree with that 100%. I think you have a plan going in, but it's like a quarterback. It's like Tom Brady, man. If the pass rush is coming at him from different places or the coverage is not what he's expecting, you look for the second or third receiver or your hot other option, and you have to improvise. I agree with that. I don't like breaking eye contact with people who are interviewing me, and I don't like being rote. If they throw you a curveball, you better whack that curveball. There's a lot of hackneyed sports analogies in that answer I just gave, but that's what you got to do.
I will say this too. You're talking about trying to maintain eye contact. I go back to where I started 10 minutes ago then, where I told folks I'm not trying to exclude them. I'm going to do my best as these shows go on to try and take some comments from folks. But if I'm looking up here at the camera, that's basically eye contact. I can't look down here at the comments because then I'm not making eye contact with you. This is the weird thing about these social media platforms is trying to, because right now I feel like I'm staring at you by at least looking through the camera at you. If I'm doing this reading, I feel like I'm not paying attention to you. That said, I did kind of shift down at one point while we were talking.
Professor Justin here?
Say that again?
The Professor Justin one that's up or another one?
We can address that one if you want.
I will
go ahead.
That. What were you going to talk about first? Because
there's at least one person, if not two, that I've seen already that have referenced UWO, Western Ontario, where you went and where this all started. And I don't think I've ever talked to you about it, but I know, as I said, doing a little bit of research and reading a profile that was written on you, I want to say maybe 5-6 years ago, in the school paper, where they talked about you just still, even at university, coming out of high school, not necessarily knowing what direction your life was going to take and how journalism, writing, broadcasting, the media world kind of came to you even later. And this wasn't necessarily something that you knew right away that you wanted to do or that you could do.
Well, I think there's a couple of things. Number one is that, Eric, I wasn't a very confident, like 18, 19 year old. Like I didn't turn 19 until my third week at university, and so much of frost week is socializing, you know, alcohol's involved. I couldn't do any of that stuff. So I was pretty nervous going to Western, and I wasn't the most confident guy. I went to Western because they had a student paper, the Gazette, that put a lot of people into media, and I wanted to be a sports writer. My dream was to write for Sports Illustrated. I didn't think I was told ever in my first ever TV interview, I wasn't good luck looking enough to be on television. I know that's very hard to believe, but it was true. And, you know, I didn't think I was going to be a TV person. I really didn't. But, you know, I didn't know what my plan was. I know I wanted to write. So I went somewhere where I could write. And I realized I was good at it. My confidence grew. And I was a good reporter. I liked reporting. I liked getting information, as you said. And my confidence grew. I think now, this generation, the one thing that they have that's easier than we did is there. You can get yourself out there more ways now than we could back then. We had to get hired by someone who would take a chance on us. Now with Instagram Live, with YouTube, with Facebook, with Snapchat, TikTok now. I mean, how many people are being turned into superstars with TikTok and Instagram? The whole idea of an influencer with the technologies that was available when we were younger, it was impossible. And that's what this generation has over us, is that they can put themselves out there, and if their content's good, someone's going to find them. But Eric, I never thought I would end up here. Like where we are now, what we're both doing now, I would have been beyond thrilled with the idea of being where we are.
Now, let me ask you this.
Can we do that, Professor Justin, for a second?
Yes, go ahead.
So Professor Justin said, you know, all these athletes give you canned answers. I really believe that a lot of the problem, not always, because some athletes won't give you anything, but I think a lot of the problem is the questions. And I really do think if you come up with better questions and you work at that rapport and you're around the Raptors all the time, so they know you, that helps, you get better answers. And I think if we were more creative with our questions and we were better at maintaining relationships, and sometimes the teams are at fault because they keep everybody at arm's length, that they don't allow the relationships to build. But I do believe between relationships and better questions, you get better answers. Now, I will say I've had some of the dumbest moments of my career when I've tried to be too cute and overthink questions. But I think generally, if you're around and they know your work, you're going to get better answers if you ask better questions. So I think a lot of the problem is not the athletes. I think a lot of the problem is also, are we creative enough?
You know, I would agree with that, Elliot, but, and I'm going to, again, I don't know if you're going to agree with me on this. I think
you're
that
wrong.
I'm going to split hairs on this a little bit, though, because for the audience as well, there's, I don't know, I could probably come up with four or five categories, but right off the bat, I could think of three different categories. There's a difference between the sit-down interview that's in a controlled environment, in a, you know, in a back room, and it's lit, and you've got your 10, 15 minutes with somebody, and you can prepare going in, and then they might feel comfortable in just a closed environment with one person. Then there's the questions and the setup that has a scrum where you've got a bunch of reporters standing in front of you with the microphones in your face. Then there's also the live interview at the end of the game or at the halftime or at the, you know, the period intermission, et cetera, where you have a specific, you know, amount of time, 45 seconds to get to something. And the guy's, you know, covered in sweat, still breathing heavy from coming off the ice, coming off the court, coming off the field. I think that there are different components that go into each one of those types of interviews or media availabilities where I'm agreeing with you in terms of the line of questioning still needs to be good. But I think there's also the mindset of the player in those moments where they might be more apt to be open, to be more forthright, to be more honest, to not be as much cliche if they're feeling more comfortable and not as pressured or as jammed in with reporters as opposed to if it were in a one-on-one type setting.
I agree with that. I think the scrum is always the toughest, no question about it. Whenever and you know, remember like Vince, I'm convinced like Vince was claustrophobic. Like you remember how Carter used to be, like people would get too tight and he would like lean back. And I think if you have any kind of that, you know, claustrophobic or anxiety or anything like that, that makes it even harder. I agree with you. I love the sit downs are great. I love watching your on court interviews. I hated it when mine went to the building. I always hated those. Like I hated it when it went to the building, but I love on-court interviews. I think there's something about an athlete being interviewed with everybody watching them that brings out the best in that athlete. I know Lowry can be really grumpy and things like that, but I watch him do those and there's something I can tell he likes being interviewed out there. Like his basketball court is his home, it's his office, and I think those interviews generally work.
Well, and Daniela's commented a couple of times, and I appreciate the comments coming in from Daniela and so many others that are writing it as well. I find the challenge for me as well, and you know I think that those that follow sports probably know this as well. But one of the toughest things is when you're used to being in a studio, and again I'm now splitting hairs a bit. When you're in the studio doing a radio interview and it's just you and a microphone, maybe a co-host, you can ask whatever you want. And it's very rare. It's not that it doesn't happen, but it's very rare for a radio producer to jump in the middle of an interview, unless they're trying to throw a good nugget at you, which is certainly appreciated. And you're open to that. It doesn't happen as much in television because the time constraints in TV are so much stricter than they are in radio. And certainly when you're in a sit down interview, in a controlled environment in television, there's not as much give and take with a producer because all is quiet on the set and it's pretty much just left to the interviewer, the reporter, and the subject. But when you're doing live, again, whether it's a halftime, whether it's an intermission, whether it's the end of the game, on the ice, on the court, whatever it may be, you're not only listening to the player and you're trying to talk to him or her and you're trying to keep in mind what your next question is. And to the points that we've just raised in the last few minutes here, you're trying to listen in case your next question doesn't even apply and you're trying to follow up on whatever they say. But then you've also got your producer in your ear who might be giving you suggestions on other questions. And then as somebody's answering, they're then also counting you down 30 seconds or they're telling you what you've got to throw to next. And all of those things are sensory overload while you're in the midst of trying to conduct a live interview, potentially in one of the biggest moments in a franchise's history or a huge playoff moment or whatever it may be. And that's, to me, where the challenge of the job and the challenge of the listening really kind of takes hold.
You know, I found that as I got older and more experienced and just had that happen more, I got used to it.
Yeah.
My producers knew with me that I didn't want a lot of talking. Like, hey, if you've got a question you think I absolutely need to ask and I haven't done it, hit me. That's number one. Number two, but don't give me a lot of counts. Say, hey, we got 30 seconds. Last question. Don't count me down. I want to hear the person. Because that goes back to what we were saying. If the person doesn't think you're listening to them, you lose them. So I was always very big on that. I like that. I really found that the less talking, the better. But if they had to talk to me, I could handle it. I got to tell you, Smitty, I was jealous of you last year.
Why is that?
Watching you guys go to the Raptors to win the championship. Like, I was jealous. I mean, obviously, I love my job. I love everything about it. But I remember we were watching the Raptors on all our off nights at the Stanley Cup. The Stanley Cup ended before the NBA final ended. So we came home and watched it. It was incredible. It was incredible to watch. I mean, I never thought I would see that happen in Toronto. And to be honest, and who knows what's going to happen here? We don't know. I was looking forward to whether they won or not, the Raptors going into the playoffs and defending the title, because you knew that if somebody beat them, it was they were going to fight and scratch and claw their way past the Raptors. And I got to tell you, I was jealous watching that, because I was like, oh man, that's going to be a lifetime thing. You're going to live to be you could live to be 230. You're not going to see too many things that are going to be better than that.
I'll tell you, you know, as you probably have been watching, I know a lot of people have as well, the reruns, the replays at night on Sportsnet and TSN and replaying this whole playoff run.
Did you see the numbers for Game 7 Philly on TV?
Yeah, almost a million, right?
Like 850,000?
Yeah.
Like that's ridiculous.
It is crazy. It is crazy. And I've been asked a bunch of times by people, you know, what was the best moment or what was the highlight moment? And it's hard to come up with one, because right away, of course, you think the Kawhi shot against Philly. But then how do you deny double overtime in game three against Milwaukee? And you were that close to being down 0-3. And then all of a sudden that starts four straight wins to blow the Bucks out and knock them out in six. But then how do you deny, you know, going into Golden State winning both in Oakland in games three and four to go up 3-1, and then obviously ultimately game six and winning the championship in their joint and winning every single road game in the finals. I mean, there were so many moments. And to me, the crazy thing, Elliot, about that run as well is that for as much as Kawhi Leonard gets the props and the respect, and justifiably so, there were so many key moments throughout that entire run from Orlando to Philly to Milwaukee to Golden State where Marc Gasol had a huge game. Danny Green stepped up a game or two. Fred VanVleet, when he finally, after Fred Jr. was born, how he just became insane from three-point range, let alone Pascal Siakam, his first finals game going for 32 points on 14 of 17 shooting. Kyle Lowry, think about him throughout the run, let alone in game six. There were so many guys that had major moments that I don't think the Raptors win the title if not for all of those individual moments, not just Kawhi being as good as he was for that entire stretch run.
Well, 100%. You never win it by yourself, right? Like, even Jordan didn't win it by itself. Even LeBron didn't win it by itself. You have to have somebody, and other guys will do it with you. But I went to Game 6 Milwaukee, and when Leonard dunked over Giannis, that's
with the left hand.
Yeah, that's the loudest crowd I've ever heard in Toronto, man. I the only thing I've ever heard, I think, that was louder than that was I was at the track in Beijing in 2008 when Usain Bolt set the world record in the 200 meters. I think that's the only crowd I've ever heard that was louder than that. When Crosby scored in Vancouver, that's right with it too. But that dunk over Giannis, I mean, that and you know the ACC, we joke, it's a wine and cheese crowd. That place went absolutely bananas. So I'm a